Would you please join J.W. Brown in our Pledge of Allegiance? You may be seated. Now you may be seated. Good morning, everyone. We are ready to begin honoring our veterans on this very special Veterans Day. We will begin today's festivities with the service songs. As to not distract from being able to see and honor our veterans during their service song, we ask that all guests remain seated during the service songs. Veterans, as our choir sings your service song, please rise and stay standing, if possible, during your service song. All guests will rise to honor our veterans at the conclusion of the service songs. Army.
the Navy.
Thank you.
morning. My name is Ross Sproul, and I'm the proud principal of Perryton High School, and I get the honor of following that act. It's amazing listening to our choir, and they come out to the foyer on Friday, game day, and sing the school song. And how many of you all here are alumni of Perryton High School? Raise your hand. Wow. You know, as you know, Veterans Day started a long time ago, evolved into Veterans Day. There was Armistice Day in 1919, was the first year I believe that it was recognized. And ironically, Perryton High School, I believe, according to my historian, Mr. McClarty, opened in 1919 as well. So you think about 100 years of service of students, former students, and soon to be former students like yourselves that have gone on to serve our country in uniform on behalf of the faculty and students of Perryton High School. I just want to say thank you for your service. Thank you for being here today. And thank you, really, it's not enough words to show the gratitude that we have for the service of our men and women in uniform. So you really think about when you hear the Pledge of Allegiance, you hear about liberty and justice for all. But the one thing you don't hear that's not in there is education for all. Whether you're a boy or a girl, every citizen, everybody in this country has a right to an education. And without the protections that our military provides this country, the bell rang twice, and to me that's a sound of freedom, is what that sound is for me. And thank you for being here. And there's a lot of things coming into a year like this that we had to decide how we were going to do things or whether we were going to do things at all. And I can tell you one thing, it was not an option that we weren't going to honor you today. So I know this looks different. Hopefully this is the only time it's going to look different. But thank you for being here and taking the sacrifice from your day to be here under uncertain times. And one thing I would say about our military is not just a blunt object. There's a humanitarian aspect to our military, as I know you're aware. And you just think about the year that we have been through in 2020. Sometimes what the military has contributed to putting up hospitals and providing manning hospital boats and mercy and comfort, and then hopefully get a vaccine out, and it's going to be the military that's going to be in charge of making sure that's handled in the right way so that we can get back to some normalcy in this country. So the military is a lot of things, but for me as an educator, this school wouldn't be here, no school in this country would be here if it wasn't for your sacrifice. So I thank you for your service on behalf of this school community, and I hope you enjoy our program. And Ms. Wade, I hope I kept it under 5 minutes. Because she said 5 minutes, because she knows I can talk. So thank you so much, and I want to hear some of your stories. Please come up and introduce yourself to me. And I've already heard a lot of amazing stories when I look at it. Well, I can only imagine stories that you could share in your time in uniform. Thank you very much.
Would you join me for a word of prayer? Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we humbly thank you for the blessings of life and for the precious gift of freedom. So Lord, direct our paths that we would daily seek that which is good and pleasing unto you. Today is an important day in the life of our nation, and we are privileged to honor these veterans. It is a national day of recognition, but it is also personal. Lord God, there are men and women who nobly serve this country and who have touched our own lives. Some are here this morning, some cannot be present, and others who are no longer with us. So we pause right now to remember these individuals as we silently give thanks to you. We ask you, Lord God, to bless the men and women who currently serve in our armed forces. May your care and protection be with them and their families this day. Inspire us all to live out the highest ideals of this nation, that we might be a beacon of light and a bastion of freedom to the world. And now unto you, Creator and Redeemer, all glory and praise be given. Amen.
Also served in the Navy from 1996
1998 to as recent as 2019. And again, could have been a good year. Cricket Jacqueline Ramirez, 2004 to 2006, served in Fort Bliss. There you go. Okay, moving back in time a little bit, and we grouped some of these as your most recent time of service, and unserved, like in this case, 21 years. I started with the ending date and grouped them according to that. So Lonnie Bailey served in the Navy as a senior chief petty officer from 1970 to 1991, served in Vietnam, Desert Storm, Desert Shield, Honduras, Panama, Libya, and Grenada, and special honor, the Bronze Star. Nikki Green served in the Army from 1989 through 1997, Fort Polk, Louisiana, Fort Clayton, Panama, and also in Amarillo, Texas. J.W. Hardy, Staff Sergeant, dates of service, 1977 through 1982, again 1985 through 1998, Saudi Arabia, Korea, Panama, and Alaska. J.W. is a PHS graduate from 1975. Greg Hodge, who usually shares his podium with me, served in the Army from July 1984 through June of 1991, Fort Hood, Texas, Germany, Saudi Arabia, and Kuwait. Price Money served in the Army from June 1990 through October of 1994, Fort Myers, Virginia, another Perryton High graduate from 1990. Okay, moving into another time frame, Mike Richardson served in the U.S. Air Force March of 1984 through October of 1993, Holloman Air Force Base, New Mexico. And I'm not sure I can pronounce all of these. There's another Air Force Base in the Republic of Korea, and also Luke Air Force Base. Still moving to another time frame of the 60s, Burl Bates served in the Army November 1961 through November 1963, Fort Sill, Oklahoma, a branch of the Army, and is a 1957 PHS graduate. Harold Cochran served in the Army, 3rd Infantry Division, from 1960 to 1962, Kitzingen, Germany, is where he served. Dale Rooster Herring, the Army, from 1960 through 1963, served in Germany as a nuclear weapons platoon participant called the Davy Crockett's. Earl Hudson served in the Army from June of 1968 through June of 1972, I don't think I got it all, is that correct, Earl, or 71, in Panama Canal. Charlie Lee served in the Army during the Vietnam era, served in Vietnam and the United States. Doug Perryton. Also served in the Army from September 1966 to July of 1968, Fort Hood, Texas, Chulia, Vietnam, and served in the Vietnam campaign, receiving the Vietnam Gallantry Cross. Dwayne McGuire, U.S. Army Field Artillery, July of 1967 to July of 1970, served in Fort Polk, Louisiana, the Vietnam War from 1968 through 1969 in the Central Highlands, and served with the 1st Field Force, 5th Battalion, 22nd Field Artillery, receiving 3 Bronze Stars, and is a PHS graduate of 1965. Robert Overton served in the Army during the Vietnam era. He is also a PHS graduate of 1967. Kenneth Small served in the U.S. Army October 1965 through October of 1967, basically in Fort Benning, Georgia, and then was deployed to Vietnam to join the 504th Military Police Unit over there, and then returned to Fort Sill, Oklahoma to serve in the Field Artillery Unit. He is a 1964 PHS graduate. Byron Simpson served in the Army from 1968 through 1970, served in Vietnam, a 1963 PHS graduate, but could not attend today. Since Lemons also served in the Army, August 1964 through August 1966, Army Artillery and Missile School in Fort Sill, Oklahoma. Dr. Jerry Whitehead, a captain in the U.S. Army from May 24, 1962 to May 15, 1969, serving in Fort Benning, Georgia and Fort Wainwright, Alaska. Roy Pointer served in the Army from 1953 to 1955 and served in Germany. Donald Simpson, U.S. Army Combat Engineer, 1957 through 1958, and also in 1963, serving in Fort Leonardwood, Missouri, Germany during the Berlin Crisis, and Gray Air Force Base. Dugan Wilson served in the Army from 1955 through 1957, served in Washington, California, and Germany. James T. Wright, Army, January 15, 1958 through November 15, 1959, class of 1953 from VHS. Jones served in the Army from 1998 to 2003 in Fort Bragg and. All right, thank you for doing it for us. We appreciate it. And then down to the World War II era, we had two that registered, and Ernest Barkley is the first one. serving in the Navy from 1943 to 1946 in the South Pacific, and he could not make it today. Our last one, John B. Hardy, served in the Navy from 1945 to 1946, served in the Pacific, and he's a PHS graduate from 1938. J.W. said he, you know, just couldn't get here and couldn't make it today, but we appreciate it and very much also. Well, that concludes the list that I have, but I want to make sure, is there anyone here in attendance that I've not introduced? I know who he is. But thank you. We do appreciate your attendance. It's quite an honor. I hope we can continue this program. But we appreciate you coming up here with such conditions as they are and taking the time to come up here and let us fellowship with you and join. And I look forward to talking to you some more of you during the meal. Thank you.
Vietnam, Desert Storm, and Desert Shield. The Three-Day War, Honduras, Panama, Libya, and Grenada. After active military duty, he served the Department of Defense as a foreign weapons analyst for 6 years. Currently, he is a self-employed rancher living near Knowles, Oklahoma. His civic involvement includes 4 years service on the Beaver County Conservation District Board of Directors. He has served on the Knowles Nazarene Church Board of Directors and the Beaver County Historical Society. He is currently the president of the Board of Directors of Panhandle Telephone. He is the founder of the High Plains Storm Girls and Boys Basketball Club and has never had an issue with basketball officials, ever, is the story I got. That's the rumor. He is the son of Leroy and Mildred Bailey and the stepson of Fred Barbie. He is married to Cindy Rogers. They have 4 children, Christopher, Aaron, Micah, and Shannon, all of which served as officers in the U.S. military. Let's give a tremendous welcome this morning to retired Navy Senior Chief Petty Officer, Lonnie Bailey.
Before we get started, I think we need to correct the record on that bronze star. I don't remember getting any bronze star, but it's a good thought. Earlier, Mr. McCarty mentioned that. I don't know anything about bronze star. I love being in Perryton, Texas. This is the bastion of patriotism, Christianity, and good people. I feel very comfortable being here, and I am flattered to be asked for the second year to be your speaker for this special day. Good morning to my fellow veterans, those of you who have worn the uniform. I admire you, I appreciate you, and cherish the sacrifices that you have made so that we can be here today. Thank you for the freedom that is secured for our children, our community, and our nation. Thank you for the love of our country and the commitment to keep us free and safe. Your unselfish sacrifice has built a wall of protection around the shores of America that graces our lives with freedom and happiness. To my brothers and sisters who've given their lives in combat, know that America will never forget your sacrifice. Know that your acts of bravery and patriotism are the very essence of our nation's existence today. To my brothers and sisters and soldiers and sailors, airmen, Coast Guard who are on active duty. We ask that God bless you with power and wisdom to subdue the enemy. And his protective shield to surround you and bring you safely home. Know that America loves you, respects you, and prays for your safety. I'd like to share a series of four stories whose actions, I think, typify the spirit and capability of American warriors. I believe there are three distinct qualities shared by American military personnel, and these stories will accent those qualities. The first quality of an American warrior is bravery. I believe the second is the freedom to think and act. And third, the willingness to fight when we're threatened. On the night of October 24th, 1942, 3,000 Japanese troops attacked U.S. Marines defending Henderson Field in Guadalcanal. The intensity of the Japanese assault in the darkness was terrifying. Through it all, however, Sergeant John Bassalone, affectionately known by his fellow Marines as Manila John because of previous activity in the Philippines, kept his cool. Bassalone was in charge of two sections of heavy machine guns, about 16 men. Eyewitnesses remember him fighting valiantly against a savage and determined Japanese attack. After the enemy put one of Bassalone's gun sections out of action, leaving only two men to carry on, Bassalone picked up a 90-pound, 30-caliber machine gun and tripod and ran 200 yards to the silenced gun section and started firing point blank into the charging Japanese. Then, despite being under continual fire, Bassalone repaired another machine gun and personally manned it, gallantly holding the line. As the Japanese bodies started to pile up in front of his emplacement, the enemy attacked Bassalone from the rear, and he killed a number of them with his pistol. Later that night, ammunition for Bassalone's guns was critically low, and his supply lines were cut off. Once again, ignoring enemy fire around him, Bassalone ran some 200 yards through the hostile lines to an ammunition point, where he gathered up shells and then battled his way back to his gunners with ammunition they desperately needed to defend the position. He crawled and sprinted through enemy fire a second time to obtain much-needed ammunition for his guns. And after making it back, he continued the battle against the enemy. Bassalone killed over 38 Japanese soldiers that night, either with his machine gun or his Colt 45. His hands were burned and blistered from the heat of the machine gun barrel, but he ignored that pain and continued the fight. Bassalone's heroism that night was recognized, and he was awarded the Medal of Honor, the first Marine to receive that honor in World War II. Sergeant Bassalone was a national hero, and the Marines ordered him back to the United States to go on war bond tour, which was vital to the Industrial War Complex, military complex. Those war bonds is what funded all of our manufacturing here. But John was uncomfortable in this assignment and demanded to be returned to the front lines. The Marine Corps, however, denied Bassalone's request to return to combat, instead believing that he could do more by remaining in the States. The Corps offered him a commission as a second lieutenant and an assignment in Washington, D.C. But Bassalone declined declined the offer, saying, "I'm not an officer and I'm not a museum piece. I belong with my outfit." On February 19, 1945, John Bassalone waded ashore with his platoon on Red Beach 2, located in the southern tip of the island of Iwo Jima near Mount Sarabachi. It was D-Day, and Bassalone was a machine gun section leader for the 5th Marines. Enemy fire was heavy from fortified bunkers, and it was murderous. Everyone was pinned down in the black volcanic sand on the beaches. Bassalone recognized that his men would only survive if they kept moving, and yelled at them to get off the beach. He shrewdly gauged the tactical situation and worked his way around the flank, single-handedly attacking and destroying the Japanese blockhouse with grenades and demolition, which allowed his unit get off that beach. A short time later, Sergeant Bassalone helped a Marine tank that had become trapped in an enemy minefield and was in danger of being destroyed by mortar and artillery fire. Despite the rain of exploding shells all around him, Bassalone managed to guide the tank to safety. But then his luck ran out. Minutes later, while moving along the edge of an airstrip, shrapnel from an exploding mortar grievously wounded him. John Bassalone died 30 minutes later. He was 27 years old. He was posthumously awarded the Navy Cross for conspicuous bravery. Corporal Joe Baldonado distinguished himself by acts of gallantry and bravery above and beyond the call of duty while serving as an acting machine gunner in the 187th Airborne Infantry during combat operations in North Korea. On the morning of 25 November 1950, the enemy launched a strong attack in an effort to seize the hill occupied by Corporal Baldonado and his company. Corporal Baldonado delivered a hail of fire on the advancing enemy, causing them to fall back in disorder. The enemy then concentrated their fire on Corporal Baldonado's gun and attempted to knock it out by rushing the position in small groups and hurling grenades. Several times, grenades exploded extremely close to Baldonado, but failed to interrupt his continuous fire. The hostile troops made repeated attempts to storm this position and were driven back each time with appalling casualties. The enemy finally withdrew after making a final assault on his position, which a grenade landed near his gun, killing him instantly. Corporal Baldonado's extraordinary heroism and selflessness at the cost of his own life were above and beyond the call of duty. Corporal Baldonado was posthumously awarded the Medal of Honor. Marine Captain John Ripley was an American advisor in the northern regions of South Vietnam. He was at Camp Carroll, a fire base near Dong Ha, advising South Vietnamese troops. Enemy artillery. On March 1972, the North Vietnamese commenced the Easter Offensive. Enemy artillery shells began raining on Camp Carroll and the fire bases in the area. The North Vietnamese Army was throwing everything they had at South Vietnam, 14 divisions and 26 independent regiments. Through intel reports, Captain Ripley learned 200 North Vietnamese tanks and self-propelled artillery were backed up for 6 miles and ready to cross the Cam Lo River into the demilitarized zone. If allowed to advance, the communists would overrun South Vietnam and take Saigon in a matter of days. The South Vietnamese losses would have been staggering. We didn't have the wherewithal to stop tanks. We had little handheld weapons, Captain Ripley commented years later. Ripley decided he had to blow up the bridge and keep the enemy from crossing the river into the demilitarized zone. He secured 500 pounds of TNT. For nearly 3 hours, Captain Ripley monkey walked hand over hand under the Dong Ha Bridge, placing satchel charges in strategic locations. He was under constant withering small arms fire. His actions single-handedly halted the advance of 20,000 communist forces. His extraordinary bravery and leadership was awarded the Navy Cross. In conjunction with Operation Anaconda in March 2002, a small reconnaissance team was tasked to establish an observation post in strategic locations in the Afghan mountains, and when able, direct U.S. air power to destroy enemy targets and report al-Qaeda movements. During the initial insertion on the mountaintop on 4 March, a Chinook helicopter carrying Sergeant Chapman and the Joint Special Operations Reconnaissance Team was ambushed. A rocket-propelled grenade struck the helicopter, and bullets ripped through the fuselage. The severely damaged aircraft performed a controlled crash. Sergeant Chapman, upon exiting the helicopter, immediately charged up the hill through snow towards the enemy position while under heavy fire from three directions. He took out two enemy personnel in a fortified position. Sergeant Chapman then deliberately moved into the open to engage a new position. As he heroically engaged the enemy, he was struck by a burst of gunfire and became critically injured. Sergeant Chapman regained his facilities and continued to fight relentlessly despite his severe wounds. He sustained a violent engagement with multiple enemy fighters for over an hour before succumbing to his injuries. In performance of these remarkable heroic actions, Sergeant Chapman is credited with saving the lives of his teammates and was awarded the Medal of Honor. I share these stories with you today to emphasize the similarity and identity shared by American fighting forces. Bravery, freedom to think and fight, and the willingness to fight are common among all of us. There are no forces in our past or present that are more revered than American soldiers, sailors, and airmen. Regarding the act of bravery, not long ago, I listened to an audio tape by Admiral Moyer. Admiral Moyer was a 19-year-old observation plane pilot during World War II. He owns the auspicious history of being shot down and sunk all in the same day. His observation plane was shot down by a Japanese Zero, and then he was picked up by a Philippine ammunition ship, and it was sunk hours later. Anyway, after the conclusion of the war, Lieutenant Moyer was detailed to mainland Japan, where he was tasked with interrogating high-ranking Japanese military figures. During this audio tape, the person interviewing Admiral Moyer asked about American bravery. And he kind of chuckled and he said, "Well, I've got a story." And he gave an example of American bravery that surrounded the disarmament of a very advanced, sophisticated anti-ship mine the Germans had. The mine was being dropped from planes into the harbors of Great Britain with devastating results. They would kind of lay there and wait till a ship passed, and then it would float to the surface, brand new mine technology. And they got to where they could detect these mines, but disarming the mines was a problem. They weren't able to disarm the mines. And so Admiral Moyer said that they called for volunteers to help with the project. And what these volunteers would do is take these mines out in the middle of the field, get on a radio, and start disarming the mines. And many of those mines blew up and killed the person that was conducting the disarmament procedure. At the end, they figured it out, and they were able to disarm the mine. The guy that's interviewing Admiral Moyer says, "My God, where did you get people like that?" And Admiral Moyer said, "They were everywhere." Regarding the freedom to act and fight, Americans, by our very birthright, embrace the concept of free thought. This is not a universal privilege around the globe. In the story of the Marine Captain Ripley and the destruction of the Camlo River Bridge, he exercised free thought, and he acted on his own, even though there was no orders from theater commanders. There's example after example of low-ranking officers enlisted who individually acted in the absence of immediate supervision and ultimately changed the course of battle. Contrary, during the first Iraq War, coalition strategy was to first target command and control factions of the Iraqi military. The Iraqi military had been closely trained by the Soviets. Soviet military doctrine does not allow for deviation from initial battle plans or the freedom of the boots on the ground to individually assess and change. Within the first few hours of the war, all Iraqi military communications were knocked out or cut. The Iraqi troops in the field froze like deer in headlights, unable to function, think, or act. What followed was one of the most one-sided military engagements in history. Regarding the willingness to fight, Sergeant John Bassalone exemplifies the deeply held commitment to protect the shores of America. He, a person who had demonstrated the highest levels of bravery and commitment, was sent home. But he wasn't happy at home. His commitment to protect and willingness to fight went beyond. He was out of harm's way. You know, earlier I mentioned Admiral Moyer in his post-war assignment to mainland Japan, where he interviewed high-ranking military officers. The question he often asked was, "What caused you to boldly attack the United States?" Their consistent answer was, "We did not think you had the will to fight." And they would follow and say, "We were seriously wrong." Admiral Yamamoto, the architect of the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor, privately said, "I believe we have only succeeded in awakening a sleeping giant." That giant was the American warrior. We gather here today to appreciate, celebrate, and canonize Perryton's, Bassalone's, Ripley's, and Roberts. We enjoy a quality of life paralleled by no other country in the world because of the bravery, the freedom to think and fight and the willingness to fight on the battlefield. Perryton's Charles Atchison's, the Russell Andersons, the Ben Gibsons, the J.W. Browns, the Houston family, and dozens more of Perryton's finest who have stepped generously forward and placed themselves on the wall that separates all of us from the tragedy and brutality often practiced off our shores. You are the warriors and the veterans whose deeds we owe the highest gratitude. I would like to also take a moment today and thank you for the farmers and the ranchers and the agricultural support community in Perryton, Texas. There isn't a national holiday to celebrate the contributions our ag industry makes to national security. So I'll say it here, thank you. During my 21 years in military service, I appreciated the food that sustained us, especially when compared to the food being served to our allied counterparts. They always wanted to eat with us, we not so much with them. I've had the privilege of traveling to the four corners of the earth, and I can tell you that nothing comes close to the quality and safety of American food. During times of war and conflict, our ag industry produces more with less without complaint. The farmers and ranchers in this community contribute a very important part of our national food supply and to our national security. And most of them do it quietly with great humility. In closing, it's Veterans Day. I appreciate what each of you have done for this country today. Without you, I don't even want to think what it would be without you. I salute you, appreciate you, and love you. God bless America.
Thank you. It is an honor to stand before you and to listen to taps. It's often that I hear taps at the graveside. It's an honor to stand here before you, servicemen and women, and for this service to recognize you and those around our country. Would you join me in a word of prayer? Father, we come to you today, Lord, in the season of Thanksgiving. Father, which we give thanks for many things in our life, and many families will gather together and give thanks. But Father, it is appropriate that we take this time and the focus of this attention to these ceremonies and these proceedings today. Lord, we give thanks to the men and women that are represented here and across our country today, Lord, that have taken time out of their lives, many straight out of school and having other opportunities and other choices in life, chose to go and to serve this country in the armed forces. Father, we are so grateful, Father, for your protection of them and your presence here today. We continue to pray for those that have lost their lives in the service of this country and their families. We continue to pray for those and give thanks, Lord, that are still in the service and active role today, and ask that you be with them and their families today. But Father, we thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to say to these individuals here, that God, that what they have given to their country, to their families, and to each of us, that Father, we are very thankful. May we in this season of Thanksgiving, Lord, take that moment of time and say, thank you for allowing us to enjoy the privileges and the freedoms that we share in this country. Thank you, God, also for the preparations of these proceedings and all the involved, and Father, that we might take this time to say thank you and to honor these men and women. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We will not be retiring the colors today, so let me just say again a great big thank you from all of us to each veteran that has given so much for our liberty and our freedoms. Lonnie, thank you so much for a beautiful, beautiful tribute to our country once again. And let me just announce to you that are here as veterans that would like to take pictures, have a photo session. So, as soon as we're through here, you can come up here and then please stay for the meal that has been prepared for you. So thank you, everyone, and God bless each of you, and God bless America.